Yep. I didn't even read this book and I hate it. Hi everyone, welcome back to Shelf Indulgence. This month we're talking about the lowest rated books we could find on Goodreads. Now for everyone that doesn't know, Goodreads is a sort of like a book sharing social media website. This is what the homepage of Goodreads looks like. You have to sign up to create an account and you add your friends, whether through like Facebook or if you know what their username is. You can add books to your currently reading or want to read. I'm gonna move down the page here. On my page, you can see like there's a want to read bookshelf. There's currently reading in red. And then you can kind of see like what all of your friends are reading, what they rated books. And it's very user friendly. It is owned by Amazon. So as an alternative to that, there is Storygraph. It is owned and operated by a Black woman. They are very open to suggestions. If there's a problem with the website, you can contact them directly. They work very hard to fix it, to make it even more user-friendly. And it's sort of similar to Goodreads in that you can add books, you can add friends, you can keep track of your reading stats, your reading challenges, and you can enter giveaways. Both of these you can find in the App Store or you can get to them through like a web browser. Both are user-friendly, both are great. They're good to track your reading, especially if there's an author that you love or a book series that you love, you can make sure that you know what all of the titles are and you're reading them in the correct order.
We're looking for lowest rated books, right? The lowest rated we could go with. So this one is just over 2 stars. It was 2.06 stars last I checked. It's called Bob Honey Who Just Do Stuff by Sean Penn. This book was originally written as an Audible exclusive. So Sean Penn reads the audiobook, but you can only get it from Audible. I also, I don't have Audible. I don't get audiobooks outside the library. I'm curious about what it sounds like because I don't understand how anyone could read this book out loud. It is written like an AI was trained on Hunter S. Thompson and the most pretentious person in your MFA workshop and programmed to try to win at Scrabble with every sentence. It's not just a bad book. The sentences are just so terrible and it's really hard to read when you don't understand on a sentence level what is happening in this book. So for it to be read out loud, I don't understand what it's like. I wish I could just... It's very bizarre. I'm not even sure what it's about, besides Bob Honey just doing stuff. It's all that happens. He just do stuff. Sean Penn, what is happening? Somebody else tell about their book. I'm not sure what's going on.
I can vouch for the fact that the book is really bad. I read a few pages that she pointed out to me, and I randomly just opened it, and I was like, wow. I mean, like she said, on a sentence level, it's bad. On a paragraph level, it's bad. It's just, it's pretty bad. I felt bad for her having to finish her book. I wanted to pick one that was low rated, which I thought also would be a little bit fun for me. So I got this book. It's called Pride and Promiscuity, The Lost Sex Scenes of Jane Austen by Ariel Erkstedt and Dennis Ashton. And it's pretty short, which was also a reason why I picked it. It was about around 2.5 stars on Goodreads. The basic premise of the book is that there's two Americans who are traveling around England following the path of where Jane Austen lived and stayed. And at one of the houses where they're staying, the owner was trying to find something and a box popped out, a wooden box, and in the box were letters from Jane Austen, her editors and her sisters, and some parts of her books that were cut. And so they wanted to try to find out if they were authentic, so they gave the papers to a Jane Austen expert who writes the introduction, sort of, who even has footnotes to like fake papers about like what the punctuation means in her book. So it's kind of pretentious in that way that they fake an expert with footnotes of papers that don't exist. And so then they go through the different books of Jane Austen and not only give me the excerpts that were cut, but like they'll say, well, nobody knows why this person was so against this person or whatever. And so this explains it. So they try to make these scenes fit in to the story. And so the beginning starts off with Pride and Prejudice, and the editor basically comes back and says, you are like a horrible, wanton woman, and this is just disgusting, and I have to cut all these different parts. And she's like, I'm like so upset, and don't even put my name on it now, just put written by a lady, because she's so upset that her things were cut. So it was really bizarre. But some of the people on Goodreads said, on the negative side, so many things horribly wrong, appalling, dreadful, unoriginal writing, not funny, the worst, odd, rude, I wish I never bothered, a big no from me, flawed execution, meh, don't waste your time, bizarre insult to Jane Austen. But there's a few people that liked it. They said it was mostly good fun, hilarious, amazing graphic but proper still, a hoot, clever, guilty enjoyment. So, I mean, it wasn't the worst thing I ever read, but it wasn't, I wouldn't say it's good in any way, but it's good conversation, I guess. Very strange. But I gave it 2 stars on mine. Wasn't the worst, but it certainly wasn't good. So Mallory, what did you read?
I actually also went the old Jane Austen route. I read Pemberley by Emma Tennant. It is the worst rated Pride and Prejudice sequel that I could find. I have never read a Pride and Prejudice sequel. I have no desire to, but I did it. This is rated 2.49 stars, which is pretty generous. But in terms of Goodreads, like, that generally means it's bad. It was honestly kind of hard to find something that was under 2.5 stars that was not just straight up fan fiction or like self-published garbage. So, Emma Tennant wrote this in 1993. It was kind of before Pride and Prejudice reemerged as like a huge cultural touchstone, because was it 94 or 95 that the miniseries with Colin Firth and Jennifer Ely came out. So in it, for some reason, she kind of throws away the very ending timeline of Pride and Prejudice. In Pride and Prejudice, Elizabeth and Darcy and Jane and Bingley get married on the same day. She decided that that was not what she wanted. So they've actually only been married for, Elizabeth and Darcy have been married for 1 year. So it takes place roughly 4 years after Pride and Prejudice. And I think the reason she changed the timeline was to make the central conflict believable. And the central conflict, which would be horrific to Jane Austen, is that Elizabeth cannot conceive an heir. And they talk weirdly openly about it with everybody, but it's still couched in the Jane Austen style. Like, all the dialogue is supposed to emulate Jane Austen style. It's not really supposed to be Emma Tennant. It was not good. Elizabeth is really insipid. It's really depressing to see her, because she's like, oh, what did I do to deserve Darcy's gracious love? He's so like gracious to love me. And it's like, she did not have low self-esteem in the first book. So, at all. So that was really irritating. And she spends a lot of time in her head, and Jane Austen never writes from the character's like point of view, like to get into their head and thought. So that was just not the right style. So anyways, central conflict, they do not have a child, and people talk way too openly about it. One of the sort of contrived plot devices to drive a wedge between Lizzie and Darcy is that she sees him talking to a little boy in the village and learns that this boy is the orphan son of a now dead French woman. And she, for some reason, assumes that this French woman was Darcy's mistress and that the boy is his illegitimate son. Doesn't really stem from anywhere. She jumps to a lot of conclusions based on very vague rumors. which is actually a little bit like her. Like, that wasn't, she takes what people, like, she takes the things people say at face value, which kind of happened in Pride and Prejudice. I cannot recommend this. It's not the worst thing. And Elizabeth is just, like, so flat and depressing to read. She's just, like, constantly wringing her hands over Darcy, not loving her. And, like, there's a contrived separation, like, Jane Eyre style. She runs out on, like, into the lawn and stuff. Like, it's just foolish. And I'm going to spoil it because there's no reason to read this. So, in the end, she is visiting Jane, who is sick because of childbirth. She's just given birth. And so, of course, there's stuff that, like, by happenstance, oh, this was all a misunderstanding. So, as it turns out, the aforementioned French woman was actually Mr. Bingley's mistress, and the child is his illegitimate kid. And for some reason, James was, like, fine with it. And Lizzie does end up getting pregnant, so everything's fine. So, that's how it's all tied up. So,
who takes the orphan kid?
Jane does. She, like, is just like, oh, I love Bingley, so I'm fine with it. Which, her character is very sweet, so I could see that happening. But all of that action that I just summarized happens in the last, like, 4 pages. For no reason. Out of 180. And, like, the first 60 pages are just Elizabeth fretting and being insufferable. So, don't recommend. Not the worst thing I've ever read, but pretty bad.
And okay,
it was
Bingley
the lowest rated.
Bingley would never.
No, I know. It's like, no.
Was
so
this
not?
Was the boy so pre-marriage or post-marriage?
Yes. Pre-marriage? He was pre-marriage, but only by like a year. So
well,
it would have been
still.
During his, but it would have been during his acquaintance with Jane after he like was in love with her. He was still with
the only reason marriage. It doesn't make any sense is because it wasn't in the Lost Sex Scenes book that
Yes. Started.
Right. You're
it,
right.
It was not in that one.
The only French woman.
Clearly not the canon.
Cut, so we just didn't know that this is the case on the clock.
What did you rate it?
Oh, for me, I would rate it about 1.5 to 2 stars. 1.75, let's go. Because like I said, it's not the worst thing. It's readable. It's blessedly short. Like you said, only 180 pages, so it took me like 2.5 or 3 hours to read. So, but I cannot recommend it.
I want to hear about Stephanie's book, and then we can talk about ratings.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Stephanie, what did you read?
Okay. So I read, if I could pick it up. Oh my God, I just hit myself in the face. We All Fall Down by Rose Abbo. It's a YA. It's the first in a duology. And it was just published this year. So Rose Abbo is a non-binary author. And in this book, she sort of uses, like, gender is very fluid, which is very cool, but at times it can be confusing because the author's like switching between pronouns for characters, and so sometimes it's a little tricky to figure out like who's speaking. But that is the least concerning part. So the main character and their sister, they're white, and the sister kills 2 police officers. And so the main character, to get their sister out of trouble, decides that it's a good idea to blame a gay black man who is in this story, like, magic was very prevalent, but then it goes away, and so they're trying to get magic back, but it's a struggle. And there's like an old city and a new city, and the old city is sort of safe, but the new city isn't. It's a lot. So the main character blames a gay black man who was like 8 feet tall, and she rationalizes it by he's like a grad student at a college, and the main character thinks like, oh, he'll be fine, he'll get out of it. He's living a relatively good life, it'll be fine. But it's not fine. And so the main character sort of like doubles down on her decision to blame this man. And it's, like I said, it's the first in duology, so it doesn't really clear, like, tie up the loose ends. And so the man that she blames for killing the police officers decides at the end that he's going to find out who framed him and get his revenge. So Rose is creating, you know, like, digging into these sort of, like, angry black man stereotypes, and, you know, it's just, it's not well written. Like I said, it's confusing. And on top of that, you're adding, you know, racial profiling and stereotypes and, you know, framing an innocent black man of killing two police officers. It's very problematic. It's rated 2.49 on Goodreads. It did go up a little bit and then it went back down. If you go on Goodreads and read the comments, the reviews, I can't show them on here because they're very angry and filled with colorful language. People are not happy about it. And I haven't seen anything where the author gives any sort of explanation or apologizes for using these stereotypes, or the publisher, actually, because this should have probably never been published. They've sort of just remained silent on it, which I think is interesting. I also am not sure if the second book is going to get published because people are very upset over it. I mean, with good reason. So I gave it 1 star. Do not recommend. Do not read it.
I think Mallory said something about this, like how difficult it was to find a book that was under 2.5 stars. Yeah. I think it's because people like me, I don't rate on Goodreads. I only rate things that are 5 stars to me, and it's very few and far between. And usually when I rate something 5 stars, I'm going to reread it.
Yep.
And that my rating system is for me only. I don't rate to recommend books to others. I use Goodreads as like a personal keeping track of my books. I don't use the ratings for anything. And I also think people don't rate because why would you finish a book that you're hating? So if you don't get to the end of the book, maybe you don't give it a rating. So there's probably tons of awful books out there, but we'll never know because nobody's ever finished reading them.
I wish Goodreads had like a DNF, like a did not finish option. I think that would make it so much easier. And then I could see why, like, one of my friends did not finish a book because, you know, whatever reason. I think that's a cool feature that they should have. And I know people have been suggesting that, or like they've been wanting it. I think one of the huge issues for me, and I think for a lot of others on Goodreads, is people will rate a book without reading it. Mm-hmm. So like for the one that I read, We All Fall Down, like they see other people are saying that it's problematic for these reasons, and then they'll give it 1 star and then just that's it. So yeah, so you sort of have to take the ratings, you know, like with a grain of salt. Like people are just rating things just to rate it, or they'll rate something that they're really excited about, like an upcoming book, and it doesn't come out for another 6 months, so they're giving it 5 stars. So it's bolstering the ratings a little bit. So Goodreads has like good and bad, you know, things that go along with it, but the ratings you sort of have to, or give and take.
Plus, sure. I think everybody looks at their ratings a different way. So yeah. For me, if I give a book 1 star, it's because I couldn't finish it. My 1 star is did not finish. And I usually put, I could not finish this book because blah, blah, blah. If it's mm-hmm. really bad, but I finish it, I usually just give it 2. That means mm-hmm. it was pretty bad, you know.
But you got through it.
But I got through it. It wasn't so horrible that I threw across the room and said, this should be burned. Don't ever like talk about it or whatever.
Yeah.
But people think of their stars in different ways, and Goodreads doesn't have half stars, which I would like to have, because sometimes you're like in between and you don't know what to do. And so you have to like, okay, is it more this or is it more that?
Right. I think Storygraph does have half stars.
I think they do too.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people also enjoy the reading challenge that you can make for a year. Like, I'm going to read so many books a year, and it keeps track of where you're at and are you on track, and so that gives people something to shoot for. You know, sometimes things will have 5 ratings and sometimes it'll have 18,000 ratings. So you look at how many ratings did they get, and you look at, I always like to look at the 5 stars and the 1 stars and then see like, well, what is the problems? Like, is it just one thing? I'm fine with that. You know, is it everything?
Or the reader in some cases.
Yeah.
Right, I mean, everybody has different opinion, so that's fine.
I don't rate books because I don't want somebody else to miss out on an enjoyable experience based on my subjective experience. But I can say, like, subjectively and objectively, this book is a...
took years off your life.
It really did. It really did. Mallory, I used that phrase earlier today.
Yeah,
I'm so frustrated with it. And it's got a sequel. So it must have done well enough to...
Doesn't the book have to have a plot to have a sequel?
Exactly.
Salman Rushdie gave it a blurb. Salman Rushdie.
Come on.
Blurbed it.
No.
So, no, he did, and so did Sarah Silverman. I wonder what else they read. I mean, Salman Rushdie, I kind of have some idea, but what else is Sarah Silverman reading that she's blurbing it pretty highly? I don't know. So, like, without knowing her Goodreads page, I can't compare it and see, like, oh, do we just have completely different tastes or what? But I'm ranting now, so we don't have much more time. We should wrap this up.
I was going to say, that's one thing that I love about Goodreads, too, is reading the reviews. Some are really, really funny. Mm-hmm. And they just, like, roast the book. And it's so good. It's so good. Especially if it's a book that I also hated, but I'm not as witty as these other people are on Goodreads. Yeah, it's fun. It's fun to read.
Thanks, everyone, for joining us for Shelf Indulgence once again. Please consider joining us in February when we revisit one of our favorite romance tropes, enemies to lovers. So we'll see you then. That incorporate the friends to enemies romance trope. So we'll see you in February.
No.
What I do.
No, what did she say?
Enemies to lovers.
What did I say? Enemies.
Wait, what did she say?
Friends to enemies, I think.
She said friends to enemies.
Oh, friends to enemies. I didn't even pick up on that. I'm just like, whatever.
I started a new genre. I like to read that book. Friends to enemies.